So before I present the design, I also wanted to introduce this concept of a UCA versus a NUCA cache. Okay, so UCA refers to uniform cache access, and you know, this essentially describes all the L1, L2 caches that we've seen so far, where I said that, you know, L1 takes one cycle access, L2 say, you know, takes 10 cycle access, and every lookup to the L2 is going to take 10 cycles no matter where you find the data. Okay, but when you have a really large cache, so if you have a really large cache and here's your cache controller, if your data block A happens to be very close to the cache controller, you should be able to service that request in, you know, as little as, say, you know, 5 cycles. But if the data block A happens to be really far away, then, you know, you're traversing these longer wires, which may cause you to have a 30 cycle access time. Okay, so if you allow blocks to have different latencies depending on their distance from the cache controller, that gives you a non-uniform cache access, right? And you can see that this obviously comes more into play when you have a really large L2 or L3 cache. Okay, you know, this is not a worthwhile feature to include if you're dealing with small caches that anyway can be accessed within a handful of cycles. Okay, so let me cover a few more design issues for these large NUCA caches. So I'm showing one example over here where you have a CPU and then you have a large L2 cache that is, say, broken up into, you know, 16 different banks. Okay, and so if you get data from here, then that's maybe a 5-cycle access. If you have to traverse a network and get data from here, that's, you know, maybe your, that's maybe your 30-cycle access. Okay, so you know, the most important issues to be considered over here are, you know, how do you map data? You also will now see that, you know, if data is placed more often in these banks over here, you'll have low latency access. And so as far as possible, you want to migrate your most frequently accessed blocks into those banks that are closer to the CPU. Okay? If a block can be placed anywhere in cache, then that also requires you to have a search mechanism, because beforehand, you have no idea where the data is going to be placed. Okay, so I'm just going to focus more on the mapping portion for now. And there are multiple ways to do the mapping. You know, let me look at the two most significant ways. Okay, so let's say that this is a really large cache which has 16 ways and let's say, you know, 4096 sets. Okay, one option is to distribute the ways among the banks. Okay, so I can put way 1 over here, way 2 over here, and so on, and way 16 goes over here. Okay, so with this kind of mapping where I'm distributing the ways, what you'll notice is it becomes harder to find a block, okay? Because, you know, given an address, it maps to a unique set, you know, let's say set 1500, okay? And the data could be in any one of the 16 ways in that set, right? So, you know, what you would likely have to do is maybe do a search across way 1 through 4 at first. If data is not found there, then you kind of advance forward, look at ways, you know, 5 through 8, then the next set of 4 ways, and then so on, okay? So, you know, this leads to a more complex search mechanism because each data block does not have a unique location. On the other hand, if I distribute the sets, right, so one option is to say that the first 256 sets are placed in this first bank. This is no longer way 1. And for a given set, all 16 ways will be found over here. Then the next 256 sets, you know, go down over here and so on. Okay, so now if I know that my data is in set 1500, I know that it is going to be in the 6th bank, right? So set 1500 will be somewhere over here. And so, you know, given the address, I send my request directly to this bank. I look up set 1500, look at all the 16 ways, find the data, and then return it back over here. Okay, so now your latency is a function of, you know, which set your data belongs to. So it's a function of what address the data is being found in. Okay, and you know, later we'll talk about a technique called page coloring, where your operating system does a very smart job in deciding what page to use for any given piece of data. And because the operating system is now having some control over the address, it also has control over the set number and the bank that the data is being assigned to. So the operating system can be used to control which bank a data block gets placed in, and thus it can influence the latency for that block. Okay, so, you know, we'll talk about that shortly. Okay, so now I've given you some background about a non-uniform cache access. We've talked about private and shared organizations. And now I'm going to describe a cache organization which, in my view, is trying to combine the best of these many approaches. Okay, so let's look at, you know, let's look at this in detail. If you look at one of these hashed green boxes, I'm going to refer to that as one tile. And one tile has a processor core on it. It has the private L1 data and private L1 cache for that core. It also has one bank of an L2 cache. Okay, so far this L2 cache bank looks like a private L2 cache bank, okay, because it's a small structure that is tightly coupled to that given core. Okay, but in reality, you know, in terms of logical terms, all of these L2 cache banks over here are put together to form a large shared L2 cache. Okay, so for example, you know, this could be a really large, let's say 8 megabyte, you know, shared L2 cache. But what has happened here is I've broken it up into, you know, many 1 megabyte slices. And so there's a 1 megabyte cache over here, a 1 megabyte cache over here, and so on. Okay, so, and for example, if I had, you know, 4096 sets in the initial cache, since there are 8 different banks, there are 512 sets over here, you know, 512 sets over here, and so on. Okay, so if I'm looking for, say, block A, I'm going to first look up my L1 caches. If I don't find data over here, I need to look up my L2 cache. Okay, so A, I'm going to say, well, you know, where does this map to? You know, let's say it maps to set 1500. Okay, so, you know, the first 512 sets are here, the next 5 till over here, the next 5 till over here. So I know that set 1500 maps to, you know, some set down over here in bank number 3. And so my request gets sent over this network to this next tile, and I get the data from here, and then I return it back over here. Okay, so you'll see that this is really a shared L2 cache, but it has been distributed, it has been partitioned into many slices, and it has been distributed across the many tiles. Okay, so, you know, based on which tile I find the data in, my latency is also going to change. So this is very much a NUCA cache. Okay, if I'm lucky and I find my data right over here in my own local slice, then I can get by with a 5-cycle access time. Instead, if I find my data in some, you know, really distant L2 slice, then I have to pay the high cost of traversing this network and then getting the data back, which could be, you know, say 30 cycles. Okay, so this is definitely a non-uniform cache access structure. It is shared because a given core is allowed to place its data anywhere in any one of these L2 banks. Okay, and it is the set number that determines which bank it is going to be found in. Okay, now if I also combine this with a smart operating system policy that knows, you know, where data gets accessed from, then the operating system can also influence the page that is used for the data, and hence it can influence the address and the set number and the bank number. Okay, so the operating system, for example, can say that, you know, any request coming out of core 0, any data request coming out of core 0, should be placed in a page which maps to this particular bank. Okay, so, you know, combined with an operating system policy, I can make sure that out of all the requests being issued by core 0, you know, close to 80% of them are, you know, serviced by the local bank. And maybe, you know, 20% are serviced by remote banks. Now, if I do this, you'll see that the behavior is very much as if I had a private L2 bank. Okay, because, you know, most of the time I'm getting my data from my local cache. And so that's, you know, say 5 or 10 cycle access penalty. And only occasionally do I have to go to other banks, and that incurs a higher latency. Okay, so, you know, this is, as I said, trying to combine the best of both worlds. I'm trying to get the low latency of a private L2 cache, but I'm also trying to get the hit rates of a shared L2 cache. Because if there is some core that is accessing a lot of data, I'm going to allow that core to also place its pages in neighboring banks or in distant banks. Okay, so in that case, you know, this ratio might become more like 70-30. But I'm trying to make sure that, you know, all that the entire working set of a given core is being accommodated by this entire aggregate L2 cache space. Okay, so that's why I kind of feel that a design like this tries to combine the best of both worlds. It also shows you this non-uniform nature of L2 cache access. Okay, so with this, I've concluded my discussions of cache design. In the next set of videos, I'll look at the concept of virtual memory, and then we'll move on to the design of DRAM-based main memory systems.